আসসালামু আলাইকুম ডিয়ার ভিউয়ার্স, ওয়েলকাম টু ইউথ আওয়ার আগেইন। আপনারা সবাইকে স্বাগত জানাচ্ছি। আমি ইসহাক। উই ওয়ার টকিং টু আওয়ার হাফ হুফাজ। অ্যাকচুয়ালি অ্যামেজিং, ইউ নো, ইউ মাইন্ড ব্লোয়িং, 2 ইয়ার্স ইন হি ডান ইট, 9 ইয়ার্স, ইউ ইজ ওয়েল, 5 ইয়ার্স, অ্যান্ড মাশাআল্লাহ ইউ গট ইয়ার স্টার টু, ইটস অ্যামেজিং। I've learned a lot of things from you, actually, but regarding communication. Do you say, like, my kids, they haven't been to Madrasa. The communication, do you feel they will be better than you, or you think?
In regards to communication, probably, me personally, probably better than me.
No, I think you're better than them. I couldn't even bring them here, honestly. So, I know you're saying you could go, of course, they're always learning process, but actually you guys have confidence. You can't bring state students here too. It's not easy. So don't put yourself down. I think you're very humble towards that. When you moved into a new platform, like in a college and stuff like that, did people say anything to you? Like, you go, oh, he's coming, this guy's got a lot of knowledge, he's come for us and he's got 9 ancestors. Were there any guys being jealous with you, or, you know, like making funny comments?
Coming into college?
Yeah.
Obviously, when people found out that I came from an Islamic background, religious background, I'm myself religious, you know, I don't mingle with the wrong people, they had kind of a view of me already from the beginning. That, okay, this guy, he doesn't mess around, things like that. So I want you to get that idea out there first. So, you know, I don't, the wrong friends don't hang around with me, things like that. So yeah, I got an idea across to them that I wanted to.
Okay, so when you choose a friend, choosing a friend is very, very important, isn't it? Technique is very, very important. Islam gives you a guideline. So what would you look for into your friend?
Into a friend?
Yeah, so you're going to make a new friend. What would you look into it?
So I would want to have somebody who balances their life. So they're on the religious side and they're dedicated on the studying life as well. So, you know, they should pray the 5 daily prayers. They should go Juma. They should be reading books on Islam. But they should also be active in biology, chemistry, maths.
Okay, but in the college you will not find many people praying 5 times, isn't it? To be honest, you're not going to find many people. You will find a few people, but because you are already a hufaz, you want to give dawah to other people. You know, if you have something good, you give it to people, isn't it? That's the duty. So you'll have a lot of people that don't pray, but they're good people. They don't smoke, they don't do drugs, they're not doing anything to gangs. They're not criminals. I mean, we stay away from the criminals, but the rest of them are good. So how would you... would you be making friends with them?
So at the moment, actually in college, basically we have like a small salah group.
Okay.
So at Zuhr time we invite people, all Muslims, anyone, to just come and join us to pray. But yes, so with regards to that, even if they're not exactly practicing, you can advise them, you can still be friends with them.
Good.
It's not like religion is a barrier between you. You shouldn't barricade yourself from other people. I came from an Islamic background, yes, but that doesn't mean that I should only socialize with Islamic people. You know, there's wiser society, there's other people out there, different religions, different backgrounds, so we should get to know them as well.
In colleges, do you guys get, like you say, you got an Islamic background, do you guys get bullied? Does people look down on you? In college, I'm talking about, I'm sure LEA won't do that, but in college, you're coming from a different perspective of life, and especially the media now, where things are seen, you know, Muslim as a bad, Muslim as, you know, extremists and terrorists, all that stuff. Do they say anything to you?
It's
negative?
Never happened to me, but I'm sure it happens in places.
Is it because of your size? They don't say anything to you?
No, I mean, not to me. I've heard people, maybe it happened to, you know, Islamophobia against young
people. It's high. Especially. You know what, I think they said about 41%, you know, racism gone high after we left Europe. So it's gone high. It's gone very, very high. Everything's going high. What would you say if someone come up to you and be nasty with you? How would you deal with that?
First, I think because, you know, we're in an area, especially Tower Hamlets, because we're in an area of full of obviously Asian community and Muslims. I mean, this stuff rarely happens, doesn't it? So I think that's an advantage that I guess I have, being in an area full of Muslims. You know, I'm kind of safe from that, from those kind of attacks and stuff.
Well, can I ask you something? You did, you know, I'm really proud of you, what you've done for your family and the kids and everybody else. Your second boy also became Hafiz already. How old is he?
It's 12.
12, mashallah. So, how long did he take to become Hafiz, full Hafiz?
three and a half.
And your daughter's coming also half, is it?
Yeah, she's alhamdulillah halfway through.
SubhanAllah. I know. It's amazing. How do you feel, man?
Alhamdulillah, as I said, it's a blessing from Allah. I chose three of my son to become Hafiz.
Do you find the extra burden, I mean, looking after, I mean, not looking after them, I mean, disciplining them, keep them in the frame of mindset for study? Because being a Hafiz, you can't. It's a lot of people actually started and then left. It's difficult. It's a difficult area to do.
It's,
but how did you manage that?
It is difficult. I mean, as I said, being Hafiz is not the hard work. It's after becoming Hafiz, maintaining it. You know, as you said, you make sure you don't forget. And I mean, as like Yunus said, well, once you finished four years ago now, and but it hasn't stopped there. Every day there's revision, there's set practice, and so that's lifelong. However long you live in this world, you always practice Quran. So it's not like you finish. You can never finish being a Hafiz. You're always like doing revision. Otherwise, it's gonna go. So I try to make an environment, a Quranic environment at home. Like one of the things, like when I wake up in the morning, sometimes they wake up before me, all the kids, and the first thing I hear is all three of them reciting. And that's a beautiful sound to wake up to, all your three children reciting, because they wake up first and they start doing the revisions.
Did you ever cry emotionally, honestly? Be honest. I'm sure you would.
That's a big blessing to have, to wake up your children reciting the Quran. And as I said, I mean, just make a Islamic environment at home the best as you can. I mean, nowadays, I mean, all this negative stuff in the society, and you're trying to bring your child into Islamic environment is quite tough.
How do you make them, how do you please them? Because I know it's difficult for them, actually, like you said, when you're young, you don't want to be in that, you know, in that style of routine of studying, because it's difficult. Mentally, you say, oh, no, I'm going to apply, da, da, da. But how do you please them in return?
They get the traits, and
okay.
It's not. I mean, it can't be too. I mean, at the same time, it can't be too harsh on kids.
Give us an example, so we know why most of our viewers, and if they have a kids, they can, you know, learn from that.
Well, my daughter, I mean, she's the youngest, and she basically gets what she wants. She's the only daughter I've got, and she's quite cheeky one as well. She every time she finishes the Jews, she'll let me know beforehand, or next Monday I'm finishing my juice, giving me a tablet so I can also get something for her. And so she always seems to get something every time she finishes a juice, one juice. And that could be anything from like a little toy, or I mean, this few weeks ago she finished one juice and we promised her we're going to get a new bed for her. So we got a new nice bed and just did the whole room up again. So this business is like you have to play around with the children, make them happy, and obviously not to be too strict with them.
What did he get after his 9A stars?
I think he's got his first 9A stars.
Yeah.
9A stars. I think we took him, I think when he finished his HIFS, he got his first phone. Then that was like 4 years ago, he was like only year 7, I think. So he got his first phone, and then we got him an iPad and all that.
I think that's good, actually. You are looking after them. They connected with you, actually. They know that you love them to be, you know, so that's why you want pushing them to learn that. That is important.
And I don't believe in being like traditional strict father and all that. I mean, I see myself friend with my children. I mean, I like to think that if my kids have any problem in life, they should come to me first, regardless of my ages. So my kid and my all other three, I always see them as a friend. Oh, and I should be a friend with them. They should be very comfortable approaching me if they have a problem in life. If they have a problem in school, college, wherever life takes them, and if I'm around, they should be able to be comfortable to come to me first.
That's
the relationship I try to build with my children.
Brilliant. Kamran, I'm going to come to you, sir. You know, mashallah, you guys are ufas. They're very proud of you guys. You know, Allah is using you guys to protect the Quran. SubhanAllah, you're a protector of Quran. It's amazing. It's amazing. Long as we have one Hufaz in the world, Quran is still safe. Of course, Allah can find different ways of keeping it. It's not a problem for Allah. But one of the ways is you learn and think. I mean, you are, I don't know how to put it in words, man. Honestly, I don't know. You know, it's amazing. How do you feel, man?
I feel good. Obviously, I want to was it good to think my ustad, especially my mom, I think mom a lot, she put in a lot of hard work, a lot of money went behind it.
Can you say mom, I love you? Can you say that?
Yeah, I can say mom, I love you.
That's good. How about you, young man?
Yep, mom, I love you.
You know what, the effort they put, actually, of course, is your dad is working and stuff like that, the mothers. Mothers are the backbone of our home, actually. It's very, very, very true. Some people can neglect them. It's so rude to do that. Even some, you know, mother died in the hands of the sons. It happened in the Muslim community. It's true. It happened in Roman Road, it happened in Brighton, stuff like that. You know, they don't deserve that at all, man. After all these things, now you're a Hafiz, mashallah. You know, a lot of young people, I could see, a lot of young people, they go to YouTube. Like, they call YouTube Sheikh. You know, they're going to find out the things they want to know. And they becoming, like, they're feeling they're like a Sheikh. I mean, they think they know everything. And they're giving photo, everybody's bad, this is bad, that bad, that bad. You know, they're creating a lot of fitna in the community and society. You know, is that what happens in your age group?
I mean, it happens quite a lot with people I know. I mean, it's not a bad thing. I mean, going on YouTube, researching, it shows they're actually active in Islam. You want to know more about Islam. It's just the way about going about it. It's like, I don't think there's enough out there for young people to learn about Islam, especially in the local community. You know, these people want to learn about Islam. They want to become active in Islam, you know. They find Islam something they want to do. You know, they want to pursue something maybe as Islamic. You know, but it's just stuff that's not out there for them, and the only thing they have to resort to is YouTube, and going online, searching stuff.
But they're going to the wrong places. They're going to the wrong, you know, website, and they becoming some of them becoming extremists. We've seen from Bethna Green, there are three sisters that went to Syria somewhere. They're connected in the YouTube. So, do you, I could book a caller. Caller, assalamu alaikum.
Hello.
Is that Mr. Ken?
Good evening, Professor Odin.
Oh, sir, how are you, sir?
Hello, can you hear me all right?
I can hear you. We're talking about education.
You are Professor Odin of...
Thank you very much, my friend. Do you like? Are you liking it?
Am I wrong? Trust me.
Okay, make sure you... Thank you. All right, Mr. Ken, we're talking about education. I'm sure you're interested. But if you call me, make sure your TV volume is down as well. Thank you. Sorry, I was talking about... I lost it.
YouTube,
yeah. So a lot of young people are actually going to the wrong people in the trap of extremist scholars or whoever they are. So how do we save them, man? What do you think we should do?
I can't say that I'm perfect at this. I sometimes, you know, go on YouTube to find out stuff from some stuff, you know. But one thing I always do is make sure I know who's saying this stuff. And I also refer back to my teachers. If I got a problem, I want to find out something, maybe a ruling or something, I always refer back to my teachers. And that's something that I think people should do. You know, go to the local imam, you know, so go to someone who's studied Islamic law, someone who studied the Sharia, then go to them and ask them, you know, this is the issue, I want to find out the ruling, stuff like that.
Do you know anyone, you know, gets involved in the YouTube and the wrong people? I mean, end up in wrong ideas? Do you know?
I don't know anyone personally, but I've heard stories. So, you know, I just advise people stay along the right tracks. So like me, alhamdulillah, for my secondary school, the doors are always open for me. So if I have any questions, any confusions that I need clearing up on, my teachers, very knowledgeable, they can help me, anything I need.
So where do the young people go, though? Because like you said before, they don't have access to imams. Not how many young people go to imams because they don't know them. And the imams are not going to them. See what I mean? Because it's the communication gap. They don't speak English and they don't speak Bengali. This is quite a big gap here now. You know, it's a bad thing to happen, but we shouldn't let that happen. So where do the young people go when they're having problems? Because, you know, like, remember a month ago, probably one of them, bullying thing happened, one of the boy died, killed himself. And bullying is one of the disasters in this country, you know, there are a lot of bullying happening, man. It's so if they have issues like that, or some other issues, where do they go to? Where do they find imam? Because there's no access.
There's a lot of organizations out there for Muslim youth, so they could possibly go to them. Now, I know of one, Muslim Youth Network. It's based in East London Mosque. That's I like to say I'm part of them, you know, I attend the circles and stuff, and it's a very friendly environment for the youth. So youth can go there, if they're having problems, the brothers are quite, you know, generous, and they'll open them, they'll open up to them, you know, take them in, and I'll help them with any situation they have.
Can I ask you to describe, if you say in 2 minutes, what does Islam means to you?
What does Islam mean?
Yeah, what does, how do you see Islam?
For me, Islam just means the perfect way to life. So Islam, it just gives guidance on every part of life you need to do. From waking up in the morning to going back to sleep, it guides every part of life. Like there's du'as, there's many pieces of advice from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how to go about the day, how to talk to people, how to pray, how to, just everything you need is in Islam. So that's why Islam just for me gives guidance, and I don't know where I'll be, what I'll be doing without Islam.
Amazing. You know, like a lot of our non-Muslim friends actually, they will think, you know, Islam is about, you know, really, really nasty, bad, brutal and stuff like that. So if any of your teacher asks you, you know, because you've been to Madrasa, they know you know Islam. So no one is talking about Islam, talks about peace, love and justice. You know, all kind of justice, animal rights, human rights, woman rights. You know, it's amazing, but because no one talking about it, they think it's nothing there. You know, they think it's nothing there. You know, so how would you deal with that? If you're one of the teachers,
I think it's partly our fault because I think nowadays Muslims have this mentality of Islam is just for home. You know, it's we just leave at home, or sometimes we have people who, you know, Jummah Muslims, they just pray on Jummah. So there's like that kind of boundary where Islam is meant to be in our house, in our workplace, in our education, in our school, and some people actually, you know, just leave Islam for the home, and that's what actually people who are trying to get rid of Islam, they're saying leave Islam at home, do what you got to do at home, pray to Allah at home, leave Allah at home, but when you come out, you know, don't worry about Islam. And that's partly awful because we do that, and that's why there's not, you know, people are not finding out enough about Islam. So because we're leaving our Islam at home, and when we come out, you know, we don't spread that knowledge of Islam, we don't tell people about Islam, because our Islam's at home, not everywhere in life.
But we had a, you know, really golden age of Muslims were, you know, scientists, engineers, they were leading everything, every field. Why is it missing now? Why do you think it's the case?
I think that's part of this comes the same reason, because Islam led them to become, you know, inventors and scientists and doctors.
Can you name them, some of them?
Some of them, maybe I know, Al-Khwarizmi, he was the creator of algebra. And through him, you know, we got algorithms, and through algorithms we got computers, games, TVs, all this kind of stuff.
Can I ask you about the women? There are a lot of women who are, mashallah, you know, brightest human beings in our history. They were big, big scholars. They were teaching, you know, the men's.
Yes, it's true.
You know, why is it missing now, man? What's going on?
It's unfortunate it's missing now. Like, Aisha radiallahu anha, she was the wife of the Prophet, and perhaps one of the most knowledgeable companions of the Prophet. So she used to actually teach in the Khilaf of Abu Bakr and Umar. A woman taught the Khilaf, the Khalif. That's something amazing. And it's unfortunate how we degraded. We haven't degraded, we've lowered them in our eyes. So there's not as many opportunities in schools, in madrasas, for them to go and educate themselves, so they can be as high as they used to be.
It's amazing, isn't it? If most of our imam, or most of our scholars nowadays are men, and they are translating the Quran, they are explaining the Quran, they are explaining the rules and regulation, because we're going to have a one-sided view because we're men. Not in all cases, some cases. And if the woman explains, I'm sure she can explain it better, her rule, her side of the story. So do you think it's a clashes of ideas or clashes of... Do you think it's the case or...?
It is becoming a case, because, I mean, if he's in town, how many opportunities do we have for girls to go and become alim? Basically, just one or two, you can count on the fingers. So I think we should have more facilities like, you know, Alimi course, you know, our sisters and girls and daughters should become Hafiza and Alima as well, and go and preach in the society as well. Because, I mean, that's one of the intention I have for my daughter. After she completes her Hifz, I'm going to go ahead and do Alimi course and go and spread the deen amongst the women. So we need women to teach women. We've got a lot of scholars around, alhamdulillah. Even in Tamil Bengali community, we have a lot of his class, they had like 9 or 10 of us growing up. So we could graduate. So we do need the same thing for the daughters as well. And give them the opportunity.
We have a call, I'm just going to go. Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. Is it possible to go through to the studio, please?
Yes, you are in the studio, sister. Who's calling?
I'm just calling. Basically, I'm a mom. I've got two sons, small, they're 5 and 1. So I'm just looking at these two brothers, like our sons, mashallah. They've done very well with the education here. So just me and my husband basically looking into giving our children into Islamic studies, inshallah, for our sons to be hafizes. Just wanted to know which school these brothers went to.
Oh, mashallah. You could ask them directly. They went to LEA, London East Academy, based in Islamic Mosque, right?
Islamic Mosque, okay.
And before you go, they want to become doctors now. So this is amazing. I mean, the young men, they've done well and they want to become. Thank you for your call, though, sisters. Jazakumullahu khair.
Thank you.
Wa alaikum salam. See, already inspired somebody, you know, mashallah. If they do well, you guys get reward for it. Milad, I was asking you, for the reason was, you know, we seem to see most of our mothers, our aunties, you know, they didn't have a freedom in their life. They were just at home doing nothing. They always have to obey, and they're just doing what they do. I mean, that's not Islamic at all. This is just a culture we, you know, grow up into. Sometimes when I look at my sisters now and my wives and everybody, I feel sorry for my mother. She didn't have that freedom. She didn't. I really feel sorry for them, you know, like, that's why they even say, look, I'm like the Faisina.
I think that's partly our fault as well, our culture. I think there's two things. There's one, like, Islamic and one culture. Islam gives women a lot of opportunities. It's amazing.
Can I come to you after the break, inshallah? Sure. Dear viewers, we're going for a small break again. I know it's very interesting topic, and stay with us, inshallah. Don't go away. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.